there are two chapters or two parts. One is for registered firms or registered entities, and one is for individuals. So individuals include sole proprietors. Individuals also contains a particular section on partnerships. I think that for the rest, limited liability partnerships, limited liability companies, banks, all of those will be covered under the corporate section. And yeah, so the procedure is the same for both. I think I mentioned it in my talk. When there is distress, the way that the distress is triggered, who can trigger the insolvency resolution process is common, one common part. So for individuals, it could be that a certain kind of creditor is able to trigger the IRP. In the case of firms or legal entities, a certain kind of creditor can trigger the IRP. But for all practical purposes, there are two parts. One is the insolvency resolution part, and if the entity can be seen as not supporting payments moving forward, it goes into bankruptcy in the case of firms, and liquidation in the case of firms and bankruptcy in the case of individuals. So it is a common code for everyone. It's got common parts. There might be slight differences, but it's the same. The question is misused by whom? There can be abuse of this code on the part of the debtor. So some debtors may take advantage of the code to set it up so that they can get off scot-free. Some creditors can abuse the powers under the code so that they are able to shut down companies that are actually going concerns, right? Any code can be abused. The question is how much better is this code in terms of controlling abuse? So people that we would like to say that if you're a debtor, that is a promoter or the management who's stealing from the company, who has stolen from the company, and that's why the company cannot pay back on its debt. We hope that the procedure that we've set up, that you need to show as the firm, you need to show at least 2 years of track records in terms of payments and operations. That is something that is going to be produced by the resolution professional. If there's any theft, they should catch it. So if you're planning to bring the company down on its knees and get it shut down by stealing from the company, this is something that you should have set in place from 2 years before. Because 2 years records, they will be looking at to see who's been stealing or if any theft has been happened. So we try to control the amount of abuse by the design of the code, but of course any law can be abused. We're just hoping that it will be minimal compared to what it has been in the case in India as well. There is a natural contract protection that a secured creditor gets versus an unsecured creditor. So banks are typically secured creditors. That means that they make a loan against some kind of a collateral. So in the code we say that you're a secured creditor, and if the company goes into liquidation, you're able to walk out with your collateral. Right? You don't have to wait and get resolution with everybody else. You can take your security and walk. In the case of unsecured creditors, they come below the secured creditors, but that's contractual definition, right? The contract that you sign when you give collateral says you can take the collateral and walk. Unsecured creditors, if there's anything left in the company, you'll get. So we try to protect all creditors as much as possible, but we respect the contract as it was written before the company went into default. So, but yes, we do try to protect all creditors. As opposed to current companies act in liquidation, you're not very clear as an unsecured creditor. If you're a bondholder, you're not very clear whether you'll get in default. Problems, yes. So when a bank goes out after the IBC is passed and the law is implemented, it's notified and implemented, and then banks start making loans after that, I think that for banks to recover when there is a default problem on those fresh new loans, yes, the IBC will be useful. This code is slightly more linear. Right? There's not going to be a confusion that's created by having one SICA where debtors and the company and the CFO can go and try to protect their assets versus RDDFI or SARFAC, the creditors have different rights. So everything comes under this code. My submission is to take a look at the code. What we have tried to do in terms of the design of the code is to make sure that the code is fair to all, right? Including debtors. So if there are suggestions that they have to give us in terms of they are seeing something in the provisions which doesn't, which is unfairly biased against the management or against the debtor, please tell us so that we can give feedback to the implementing ministry to continue.